Hello and welcome to interest.co.nz. I'm Gareth Vaughan with another of our Double Shot interviews, and I'm joined by Shamabile Yacoub, who is the Principal Economist at the New Zealand Institute of Economic Research. Welcome again, Shamabile. Good to see you.
Thank you.
We're here today to talk about 2015 and what we're going to see next year in the economy. So both we thought we'd have a good look both internationally and domestically. So Shamabile, if we kick off globally, I guess, you know, we're in a really interesting position, all sorts of things going on around the world. I guess if you give us a bit of a summary first of where you see, I guess, the risks and the, I guess, the bright points in the global economy that are likely to come into play during 2015.
Yeah, so this global growth story has been so uneven, and I think that's been the big characteristics of this long recovery after the GFC. And it has cast a very long shadow. You know, what we see is growth is not even and synchronized across the global economy as we have seen in the past. We've got some bright spots, particularly in places like the US. We're starting to see some pretty concerted evidence that there is a recovery taking place there, which is really good. Biggest economy, all of those kinds of things. But at the same time, we're seeing a few risks. So from a macro perspective, the moderation in growth in China, the renewed recession in Japan, slowing growth in Australia, which is a very big trading partner for us. But more importantly for me, the stagnation in Europe, coupled with the sort of the geopolitical risks around Ukraine and Russia, that's starting to become more of a risk looking forward. Geopolitical risks are very critical because, you know, these are sort of low probability but high impact events. And when you throw in an economic decline with geopolitical risks and financial markets, it can have far-reaching consequences, as we saw in the last Russian financial crisis and all of those kinds of things. New Zealand is vulnerable to those aftershocks.
Absolutely. And commodity prices have been very interesting, obviously falling. We're hearing a lot about the dairy prices through the Fonterra auctions here in New Zealand. Oil price falling a lot recently too. What's your outlook for commodities next year?
Yeah, so the story on commodities is really interesting. You know, we think commodity prices will stay low for the next couple of years, but it's so hard to predict because right now we've got a few things happening. One is supply has increased and demand has suddenly been less strong than we thought. At the same time, the geopolitical tensions in Russia has meant that supply that would have gone to a big consumer like Russia is suddenly flooding the export market. And all of those things together are creating this very unusual and unfortunate event where commodity prices are coming off very rapidly. For New Zealand, it has two consequences. First, of course, for our farmers, it means that their returns are going to be quite a bit less than last year. So that's roughly, $5 or $6 billion that are not going to be earned as revenue. So that's pretty big. But at the same time, we have a little bit of offset from lower inflation, particularly through oil prices, that gives us a bit of a buffer. And I think that's a bigger story about what's happening in the global economy, in that there is just not a lot of inflation. You know, there is not enough growth, not enough demand, and not enough increases in prices and commodities to fear for inflation. Right now, the real risk in the global economy is really about growth and the risk of stagnation and slow inflation. That's a much bigger risk.
Obviously, from a New Zealand perspective, our two most important trading partners these days are Australia and China. If we start with China, what are you expecting to see in China next year?
So China is slowing. The great rate of growth is slowing. So we think it's probably going to be just under 7% next year, which is still a very strong pace of growth. But the important thing for New Zealand is because growth is shifting from investment-led to consumption-led, in many cases, it's actually a good thing for New Zealand. So the demand for soft commodities, particularly for food products, remains very strong. But it has some implications. For example, the demand for forestry may not be as strong. And for our second largest trading partner for Australia, which is very focused on the mining resources, for them that moderation or the weakness in investment is a really big challenge. And I think that's the knock-on effect is probably more important for us because of the kinds of things that we export to Australia are so different. They tend to be much more value-added, much more manufactured, much more processed. And unless Australia is growing well, that more high-value manufacturing parts of New Zealand economy really miss out on a consumer.
And China's not looking great at the moment. I mean, GDP, you know, coming in pretty weak. Talk of potential interest rate cut from the Reserve Bank of Australia. What does all that mean for New Zealand?
Well, you know, on the one hand, it might look like the New Zealand exchange rate might be quite favorable in terms of the Australian dollar coming off, nice to go for holidays. But in reality, what we're talking about is an Australian economy that's slowing and is suffering from a lack of demand. And that's a very big risk for New Zealand because it is our second largest trading partner. It means that the demand for our goods and services won't be there, and we may not get as many tourists as we're used to, because it is by and far our biggest source of tourism. So on those two fronts, a slowing growth rate in Australia is a risk in terms of our outlook for manufactured exports and for tourism. But at the same time, the Reserve Bank of Australia is quite pragmatic, and they will cut rates if they think that they can inflate demand. But we have to wait until the beginning of February to see that happen, and perhaps the economic consequences, that stimulus coming through middle of next year. So it's a long wait.
If we turn to New Zealand now, and we start with the housing market, we've had some figures out in the last couple of days, obviously notably the Barfoot and Thompson figures for Auckland showing record higher median prices again, sales volumes beginning to pick up, supply issues are still there. But if we look at what we could expect to see in the housing market next year, I guess Auckland specifically, and then more broadly the New Zealand separately, rest of the New Zealand market.
So I think in terms of the housing market in Auckland, we've got a very different dynamic compared to the rest of New Zealand. Certainly from an economic perspective, there's a huge amount of support. So Auckland's been the place that's been the engine of economic growth, jobs, incomes, you name it, as well as very strong population growth through net migration. And, you know, the statistic that was really frightening for me is last 7 years, 80% of all new jobs have been created in Auckland. So it is very much that there is that very strong economic support underneath that. But at the same time, prices have risen to such a level that they're very disconnected from incomes and rents. And, you know, that remains a very big source of vulnerability. Whether or not we think house prices will fall rapidly, we can't see it falling much. But at the same time, if the housing market, this renewed second wind that we're seeing in housing, if that continues, the Reserve Bank will clamp down. And I'm really frightened that if the Reserve Bank reacts on housing, the toll it will take on the rest of the economy, both in terms of other provinces, but also sectors outside of housing, will be quite negative, because we'll be in an environment of, relatively speaking, slow growth, very little inflation, and in fact, banks are probably going to become more resistant to lending to businesses. So that takes me to this, I guess, the rest of New Zealand story in terms of housing. Canterbury is slowly starting to moderate, so supply is finally starting to catch up. We're starting to see that in the sort of early parts of the market, like rents. Rents are not growing as much. Labor cost inflation, which used to be very, very high, is starting to moderate. All of these things tell us that the repair work in Canterbury is probably going to be done in the early part of next year. That'll release a lot of capacity, and the Canterbury housing market, which has also been very special, will moderate. In the rest of New Zealand, which has added almost no jobs in the last 7 years, I can't see much happening. You know, it's very much about prices have returned to levels that make sense relative to rents and incomes, and we expect them to grow modestly in line with those things.
Just picking up on your points about the Auckland housing market and the Reserve Bank possibly taking some action, be interested to hear firstly what you think they might do if the second wind really does kick on, and secondly what you think they should do, because you've obviously got concerns about the impact of their their moves to call the Auckland market on other parts of the economy and other parts of the country.
Yeah, so I think in the first instance, if the Auckland housing market starts to pick up, the Reserve Bank will focus very much on investors, because that has been the biggest source of demand for house purchases over the last couple of years. So they've already talked about a few things, particularly around reassessing how people with, I think, five or more properties are assessed. That's probably going to be the first cab off the rank. But what I would like to see is probably a pragmatic approach in terms of thinking about maybe a loan-to-income ratio, which the Bank of England and the RBA are thinking about, because it limits the amount of credit available in the economy, and the bank's still choosing who's good risk and who's poor risk. The second thing that I think would have a much bigger impact is actually getting banks to hold more capital, because, again, that would limit the amount of credit in the economy. The final leg, which is probably the most painful, is raising interest rates. We've already seen the Reserve Bank do that this year, and we've seen that it's had a big impact in terms of provincial economies, the rural economy in particular, and non-housing businesses. But if the housing market starts to take off again, I don't think the Reserve Bank will have a choice but to clamp down pretty hard, because we know that house prices are so detached from fundamentals, a sudden slowdown could be really quite painful.
Absolutely. So that's a big thing to watch next year. And another area that's been really strong has been migration. Mm. I think the last annualized figures were 47,000. Some predictions of 55,000 next year. What's your outlook for migration next year?
So until about a day ago, I thought it would be going the other way, moderating, mainly because I thought the Australian economy would be slowly starting to heal. Instead, what we're seeing is an Australian economy that's still in a very slow patch of growth. And unless the labour market picks up there, we can't see the net migration numbers with Australia picking up anytime soon. So net migration has been very strong, and it's been two big sources. The first one has been far fewer people leaving for Australia. That's had this very distributed across impact right across New Zealand because it's fewer people leaving from everywhere. The increase in arrivals has been quite interesting and a little bit different from what we have seen in the past. The biggest source has been students. So, they add a slightly different kind of demand to other people. The second lot has been returning Kiwis from Australia. And the third one has been people coming on work visas, particularly from the Philippines and surprisingly from France. I don't know what the French people are doing here. But what we're seeing is this quite a unusual dynamic. And what we saw, for example, in the early 2000s with a big rush of migrants coming in, creating this massive pressure for housing demand in Auckland. And that came through in things like rental prices really, really quickly. This sharp increases, and from memory, rental inflation in New Zealand peaked at something like 9% in the early 2000s. This time around, we've got very little inflation in the rental market, and we're still not seeing any of that evidence that net migration is having that, profound impact on housing supply and demand. It may be that it is still to come, because population growth, eventually people got to live somewhere, they've got to buy things, they've got to be part of the labour market. It just feels like right now the impact of the increasing supply in the labour market and all of those things are probably having a bigger impact than the inflationary impact that we would have expected from the consumption. But net migration remains something that's very critical to watch for New Zealand. Given our small population, changes in net migration can have a very big impact in terms of the underlying demographic demand drivers for the economy.
Absolutely. Now, a couple of other things I thought would be good to touch on. Inflation. You've already mentioned there's not much of it anywhere in the world at the moment, really. I think our last annualized figure in New Zealand was 1%. Mm-hmm. What are you expecting next year?
We think inflation is going to be quite low, and the big influence in the early part of next year, of course, is going to be the pullback in oil prices and some of the commodity prices that we're seeing internationally. But that's probably less of an issue for the Reserve Bank than what's happening in the domestic economy. And in the domestic economy as well, we're not seeing very much. So businesses remain very cautious about raising prices, and in part because there is not a lot of those cost increases coming through. Again, for example, one of the biggest sort of sticky bits of inflation tends to be the labor market. And labor cost inflation is really subdued. And there's so many people competing for a few jobs that we're not seeing that kind of sticky wage inflation coming through. And I think it's partly that unevenness story, because the job losses were widespread, but the job gains concentrated in a few places and a few occupations. There's this kind of this concentrations of inflation, but in large parts of the economy, there is very little inflation because there's so much excess capacity.
And what about interest rates? I mean, we came into this year with the expectations of a sort of 2-year hiking cycle from the Reserve Bank. They did, 4 hikes to the OCR, then they stopped. Now no one really expects them to move it until late next year, if even then. And obviously, mortgage rates have been coming down. Yeah. So it's an interesting dynamic there too.
It is. I think interest rates are becoming a very hard call. If I looked at just the economy in terms of growth and inflation, we don't think there is any catalyst for interest rate increases well until year after next, so 2016 some stage. But the big kicker here is going to be what happens to Auckland housing. If the housing market picks up, the Reserve Bank will react and they will snub it out. So there is a real risk that the collateral damages the rest of the economy. So I'm hedging my bets here, but if it was just the economic management side of things, we would say absolutely no interest rate increases until 2016. But if the Auckland housing market starts picking up, which is a source of big risk for both the economy and the financial system, the Reserve Bank will be forced to react, and they could hike by the middle of next year if the current tick up in housing continues.
And finally, the New Zealand dollar. Now, that's another interesting one to try and look at too, especially with what's going on in the US, what will the Fed do next year, etc. What are your expectations?
The New Zealand dollar has been such a hard call. I mean, it's still hanging up at such a high level, despite commodity prices coming off and all those kinds of things. Given what's happening in the global economy in terms of this very slow growth and risks to it, it's very hard to see quantitative easing in a global scale coming back anytime soon. So this competitive devaluation of currencies continues, and New Zealand dollar is the kind of the collateral damage. I think our dollar will stay high because of that, and that means that our exporters will still have to plan very carefully in terms of managing their revenues and cash flows.
So more of the same on that one, probably.
I suspect so, because relatively speaking, New Zealand will do better than a lot of other places, and our interest rates will be higher. We are not printing money like others. All of those relative factors, despite falling commodity prices, means that New Zealand dollar probably will hang up at a fairly high level.
Well, great. Thanks a lot for that, Shamabil. That's Shamabil Jakob, the principal economist from the New Zealand Institute of Economic Research. And I'm Gareth Vaughan at interest.co.nz.